So what I'm going to argue is that traditional peer review has really no evidence to support it. You are scientists or pretend scientists, as is Tracy, and therefore you're interested in evidence, and all the evidence shows that peer review is largely useless. I think it's a huge irony that it's a faith-based process at the very heart of science, which is supposed to be all about evidence. It's great in theory, but it doesn't work in practice. Then I'm going to argue that post-publication peer review is the review that really matters right now, let alone in the future, and that Web 2.0 can increase that, can enhance it. So what is peer review? Because often it isn't at all well defined. There is no, I suggest, no clear operational definition. There are as many systems of peer review as there are journals and grant-giving bodies and other people who do peer review. It's clearly something to do with using a third party to scrutinise a document or a grant proposal and decide what should be published and what should be funded. But I want to draw the distinction between pre-publication review, that elaborate, tedious, never-ending process that I was much involved with as editor of the BMJ, and the post-publication review, when the world decides, does this matter or not? And my argument is, that's the real peer review. This traditional peer review, or pre-publication peer review, is a waste of time. So what is it for? Well, it's for selecting the base studies, the best studies. It's for quality assurance. It's for improving what is published. It's for detecting errors and detecting fraud. And I'm now going to tell you that, unfortunately, it does all of those things extremely poorly. So we have lots of evidence of its downside. We have almost no evidence of its upside. So most of you will be familiar with the Cochrane collaboration. It does its systematic reviews. I think few of you could argue that it isn't the highest quality evidence we have. Their conclusion of their systematic review on peer review is, at present, little empirical evidence is available to support the use of editorial peer review as a mechanism to ensure quality of biomedical research. So we don't have evidence of the upside. But there's lots of evidence of the poor side. Much of what is published is of very poor quality and has very little impact. You're probably familiar with the work of Brian Haynes and people at McMaster. So looking at, you know, where is the meat, they say, in clinical journals? They're looking for original articles that, A, are scientifically sound — they have a very strict definition of what they mean by that — plus clinically relevant. What they find is that in something like the BMJ, which I used to edit, it's about 5% of the original article. So in other words, 95% not really telling anything people need to know, or they're not scientifically sound. And in specialist journals, it's less than 1%. I imagine most of you are familiar with that work, which he's repeated time and time again. Here's a quote from Doug Altman, statistician, has done many different studies on the quality of statistics in journals, and he said, "What should we think about researchers who use either wrong techniques, either willfully or in ignorance, use the right techniques wrongly, misinterpret their results, report their results selectively, cite the literature selectively, and draw unjustified conclusions? We should be appalled, yet numerous studies of the medical literature have shown that all of the above phenomena are common. This is surely a scandal." So peer review is not working in terms of sifting out stuff that is poor quality. Drummond Rennie, deputy editor of JAMA, the person who's done more research than anybody else into peer review, conducted the peer review congresses. We've now had six of them. He says, and I think this is the greatest sentence ever published in a medical journal. It's one long sentence, but it's a fabulous sentence. And in fact, after he'd written it, somebody sent it to him embroidered. He has it hanging on his wall. "There seems to be no study too fragmented, no hypothesis too trivial, no literature citation too biased or too egotistical, no design too warped, no methodology too bungled, no presentation of results too inaccurate, too obscure and too contradictory, no analysis too self-serving, no argument too circular, no conclusions too trifling or too unjustified, and no grammar and syntax too offensive for a paper to end up in print."
And then, of course, we have examples of really appalling papers that get published. The peer review completely has failed to deal with the MMR paper in The Lancet, the Bristol Cancer Health Study, the Vioxx paper in the New England Journal of Medicine. There are no end of papers that turn out to be appalling nonsense. So, what are the other problems with peer review, apart from the fact that it fails to work completely? Well, it's extremely slow. I mean, there are still plenty of journals taking years to publish. I've just been talking to a friend of mine, a fellow of the Royal Society. He's got a paper that I think is extremely important, but it's been taking about 2 years going backwards and forwards from journal to journal. Nobody's said it's scientifically unsound. It just hasn't made it through because they don't quite want it. It's a very expensive process. It used to cost us about 60, 70 quid a time to review a paper at the BMJ. And I'm arguing that that's money that's largely wasted. It wastes the time of scientists. They should be spending their time not peer reviewing, but getting on doing important original research. You can get anything published anyway, as you probably know. Probably some of you publish the kind of journals where anything can be published. We can go there. VTech Triage. You know, VTech Triage's marvellous story when he went to speak to Elsevier, about the Biomed Central journals at the beginning. And they said to him, but surely, VTech, you're just publishing rubbish. You're making money out of publishing rubbish. He said, you are the people who make the money out of publishing rubbish. You make billions out of publishing rubbish. Which I think is absolutely true. It's largely a lottery. When you ask different peer reviewers whether they agree or not, it's only slightly higher than you'd expect by chance. And Fabio Cassati, a professor of computer science in Turin, and founder of the Liquid Journal, which is being funded by the European Union as a research study, says, we've studied this and found that peer review doesn't work in the sense that there seems to be very little correlation between the judgment of peer reviewers and the fate of a paper after publication. Many papers get very high marks from the peer reviewers but have little effect on the field, and on the other hand, many papers get average ratings but have a big impact. Then peer review is completely hopeless at detecting errors. We did a whole series of studies at the BMJ like this. So the first one we did, we took a paper that had 600 words, it was about to be published, we inserted 8 deliberate errors, we sent it to around 300 reviewers, we got a high response rate, nobody was spotted more than 5, the median number spotted was 2, and 20% of the reviewers didn't spot any. And that study we've repeated again and again, always with those kinds of results. It is biased. Another problem with peer review. The famous study that many of you will be familiar with by Peters and Secchi, they took 12 papers that had already been published in prestigious psychology journals. They then retyped, and they were all papers from kind of Harvard, Yale, etc. They then retyped the manuscripts, put a different address, the East Jesus Institute for Human Development, Montana, and changed the title. That's all they changed. They resubmitted those 12 papers to the same journals. Only 3 of the journals recognised that they'd already published the paper, and 8 of them rejected the article. Evidence of bias that they'd already published them. Then, of course, peer review is anti-innovatory. It's a lower common denominator process. And there's a whole list of famous papers that were rejected by peer review. The Krebs article on the citric acid cycle led to a Nobel Prize, was rejected again and again. Glick's identification of beta lymphocytes was rejected. Burson's paper on radioimmunoassay, again, won a Nobel Prize. It isn't really surprising when you think about it, because peer review is a lower common denominator process. It's about small minds sometimes tackling with big minds, which is why, Van Gogh never managed to sell a painting in his lifetime. Beethoven's late quartets were written off as just noise. If you do something really original, you won't be able to, you'll get it rejected. So, evidence on the downside. Drummond Rennie, who I've quoted already, concludes by saying, if peer review were a drug, you'd never be able to get it on the market, because we have no evidence of its upside and lots of evidence of its downside. My argument is that post-publication review is the real review. Once it's out there, the world decides what matters and what doesn't matter. And of course, most things don't matter. But the things that do matter will eventually come through. And I think Web 2.0 can hasten that, because it can spread the word very quickly. I find that most of the interesting papers I come across now, I get through Twitter or through Facebook, people I know and like, who I know will be reading interesting things. I read the Twitter and I access the paper. And I think, too, the Web 2.0 can really help with the process of detecting fraud. So Hwang Woo-suk, you know, the Korean, who I think is the great kind of fraudster of our time, although it begins to be a lot of competition. I mean, he was detected by people blogging. And that's where it first came from. And it was quite a while before science and nature responded. So Charles Leadbeater, one of the kind of gurus of the new age, says that we are moving from a world of I think, so a couple of peer reviewers think it's okay or it's not okay, to a world of we think. And a world of filter then publish, which was the old world, which perhaps many of you belong to the new world of publish then filter. So, it's useless. Post-publication review is the real review anyway. Why doesn't it happen? Why is it still going on? Well, of course, the first answer is there are far too many vested interests, existing journals, big profits, employment. I mean, if we're spending £70 a paper reviewing papers at the BMJ, there are 5,000-6,000 papers a year. There's a lot of money in there. It's a lot of employment. It's a lot of time. That's one reason. Secondly, and I'm sure Tracy and perhaps some of you will tell me about, you know, anecdotes of papers that were undoubtedly much improved by peer review, and there perhaps are such papers, but A, they're anecdotes, there's no proof, and B, for every paper that's improved, there's probably another paper that's made worse. So, and then another argument is, well, if we abandon peer review, there'll be too much rubbish published, people will be told that porridge cures cancer, and they'll all be eating porridge, or people get terrified. Well, that happens right now, because there's loads of rubbish published. You can get any rubbish published. And even if you can't get it published, you can bring up the Daily Mail and just send them a press release. And I think it would be so much better if we were to live in a world where the full data were available immediately. So my conclusion, scrap pre-publication review. Take all those resources that are locked up in that worthless process. Release the assets. Open science up and let it breathe. Thank you.